Welcome to Portland State Aerospace Society's fall orientation. We are POCU's open source space program. Next slide. So some background, what is PSAS? We are a club for rocket science for all. So we have interdisciplinary activities. So if you are, you know, business, math, engineering, anything like that, we can find a home for you here. We are crowdfunded, and so you can donate to us if you have a rich uncle, as Andrew would say. And we are completely open source, and so we do license our work under open source licenses. And not only are we open to PSU undergrads and graduates, but we also have industry advisors who are engineers or retired engineers that are coming in and helping us. And we're also open to students at other schools, so PCC, Mount Hood Community College, anything like that. Everyone is welcome. Next slide. So some of our technology roles, we have mechanical, computer science, electrical, and systems engineering. So a ton of different ways to get involved if you are in a technical major. And I think you all can read that. But oh, I should mention that at the end, we will have breakout rooms. So you will be able to go, I think we'll send a link, and it's not going to be like the typical Zoom breakout rooms. They'll just be separate rooms that you can hop into in and out of on your own desire to go and see if you're interested in something specific that we cover. You can go talk to someone and see how you can be on that team. So we don't require any sort of application. Like once you join, you're in. So it's pretty easy to kind of jump around and see what you're interested in. So for management roles, we have accounting, marketing, supply chain, and human resources. So also a bunch of ways to get involved if you are more of a businessy person, but you can also do both. So we have people who are, you know, engineering that want to help with social media, anything like that. So, you know, whatever you want to do, we can find a place for you. We also have professional affiliation. So we house the PSU chapter of AIAA, which is the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. So there are conferences that we both host and can attend as an AIAA member. There's internships, job opportunities. It's just a really great way to connect in the industry, as well as IEEE, which is something electrical engineering. Andrew can correct me. I'm mechanical engineering, by the way, if you don't know me, but yeah, so those are kind of the two biggest affiliations that we have. Next slide. We are also a chapter of SEDS, which is Students for the Exploration and Development of Space. And so this one is also fairly new, so it's still kind of developing, but it also is similar in the fact that it gives us some connections to people in the industry and also connections to other university teams. So we can connect with other SEDS chapters, see what they're doing, and it's a great way to connect with people doing the same thing that we are at different schools. We also house Women in Aerospace, PSU. So this is my student group that I started last summer. And this is affiliated with WOAA, which is Women of Aeronautics and Astronautics, part of AIAA, and SWICE, Society of Women in Space Exploration, which is part of SEDS. And you don't have to be a woman to join. We are open to everyone. And this one is, we meet weekly, Wednesdays at 6:45, and we also bring speakers in, and everyone is welcome to attend those as well. And you can talk to me. We don't have a breakout room for that, but you can talk to me if you want, or send us an email. Next slide.
Okay, so Vikings Business Aerospace Professionals, it's new student organization as of fall 2020. We're looking to raise awareness about the aerospace industry and opportunities for PSU students. We're hoping to diversify and grow the business aspect to aerospace with this student organization. And we plan to have like monthly talks with industry professionals where our members can gain insight and experience. We will actually be having our first guest speaker aerospace supply chain, Derek Westfall, coming this November. So stay tuned, and you can reach out to PSES or myself to gain more information as we grow this student organization.
Cool. All right. So why rockets? So anything that you do in a lab is going to be safe and predictable, right? Anything that you do in a lab for class, they make sure that you're not going to sue them. But rockets are hard and they can kill you. So we want to challenge ourselves and do the scary thing, obviously. And our eventual vision is to send a 1 kilogram nanosatellite into orbit. Next slide. And so how hard could that be, right? So here you can see that it's actually very far. So the von Karman line is the 100 kilometers, which is kind of regarded as that edge of space. And so that's kind of what you would need to get into to be in space. So the conclusion is that orbits are hard. There's some math here that I'm just gonna skip over, and Andrew will definitely interrupt me if he feels the need to.
Yeah, I totally do. So go back a slide. So the thing to say here is that most people don't understand, and we're gonna, Katie doesn't wanna talk about this because she doesn't wanna insult your intelligence, but I'm totally able to do that, so that's fine. So what does going to space mean? Most people don't know that. And the 100 kilometer line is the edge of space. But of course, if you throw a baseball up past 100 kilometers past the orbit of the moon, it's still coming back down. We're still at the bottom of a gravity well. So most people don't talk about what the fact that going to space really means getting to orbit. And so we've only done suborbital flights, but you'd have to do an orbital flight to get something and have it stay in space. If you go to the next slide. So why is this hard? Well, going up is not that hard. Going up is like 10% of the energy that you need to get to orbit. 90% is that 7 kilometers per second of the orbital velocity to go around the damn planet. And that is a 1 kilogram Coke can is like about 155 pounds of TNT's worth of energy into that 1 kilogram Coke can to get it into orbit. So think of the amount of energy in a Coke can that could take out an entire city block, right? It's a tremendous amount of energy, and that's what's hard. And so we might get to 100 kilometers. We will probably never get to orbit because that's a huge rocket, and it will probably cost on the order of $1 million. And we like to joke it will take more metric tons of lawyers than it will take metric tons of fuel to get to orbit. So anyway, keep going.
So yeah, so it'll never happen, but we're gonna try to anyway. So here you can see some scales. So if you look on the left, you have just a standard astronaut height and LV2, that was our third rocket. So you can see how that stands up in comparison to an astronaut and all the way up to some popular rockets. So they are large, and we will never make a Saturn V. Yeah, basically. So then what can we do if we're not making a Saturn V? Well, we can pioneer technologies. So we can make big lightweight airframes, powerful scalable motors, guidance, navigation, and control. But we also need to work on the logistics of it and project management. And also we still need money and lawyers, please.
So again, reach out to your rich uncles.
Yes. Any rich people you know. and so our launch vehicles, LV0 was the first one, which I believe was just an off the shelf rocket. And then they've kind of developed over the years since 1998. And you can kind of see just how they've scaled up. And we'll also get more into the details specifically of LV2, LV3, and LV4 in this presentation. So we were founded in 1998, and two of the members in that picture are still super involved with PSAS, which is great because we're building on that knowledge. And so even though It says ancient history. It's still great because we are pretty established, and I like to think we somewhat know what we're doing. Andrew might tell you otherwise.
Ish, always ish.
20-year launch history. So yes, 1998, you can see Andrew usually says that we try to launch every couple years.
Every year.
And yeah, so about every year. Obviously things are a little bit different now because of COVID-19, but you can see our last launch was in 2018. Bragging rights. I'm not going to get too into the nitty-gritty of this because you all can read and we're also recording this, but yeah, we've done some super cool things over the years, and because we were founded in 1998, that does give us quite a history of bragging rights. So other bragging rights, we have student placements. So when you are working in PSAS, you're getting that hands-on knowledge and work that employers like to see. So we not only build rockets, but we also build better students. We've had internship placements. This was just this past summer is what these are referring to, the NASA and NASA Academy in Lockheed Martin. But if you think all the way back to 1998, all the different companies, so job placements at Blue Origin, SpaceX, NASA Marshall, Firefly, so, you know, you're really setting yourself up for a future career. So 2019 to 2020 accomplishments, we are part of the Base 11 Space Challenge. So we won $15,000 as part of that challenge. We've raised $30,000 in NASA grants. So not only are you getting that, if you're in a STEM major, not only are you getting that STEM work, but you're also going to be working on writing grants and papers, proposals. So you get a lot of that technical writing experience that employers like to see, and you can also add it to your resume and your LinkedIn. So that's really cool. And you're also earning money for not only yourself, but also PSAS so that we can grow further. We've also raised $5,000 in the PSU Day of Giving. So we are crowdfunded. So you'll probably see that again in November. We present in professional aerospace forums. We hosted our own expo, the second one this year. And we're also at conferences, both local and national. And yeah, the Pacific Northwest Aerospace Expo we created and hosted. We had the second one just a couple weeks ago.
And we failed to add this to the presentation, but Jennifer Jordan wants a shout out. We also won, $4,000 at CleanTech?
Oh yeah, we should talk about that.
So now we'll tell you a little bit about LV2. LV2 stands for Launch Vehicle 2. And this was our longest living, most successful rocket to date. However, it is currently retired and on display in the rocket room, which I would invite you to go check out, except that we don't have access right now. So that's a picture of the system architecture. Apogee, which is the highest point in its flight, was at roughly 5 kilometers. And its maximum velocity was Mach 1.2, so 1.2 times the speed of sound. The goal for LV2 was never to send it up as high as it could possibly go, but to demonstrate a variety of technologies within a rocket. So one of those things we wanted to demonstrate was an Ethernet-based avionics system. And so this right here is what may possibly still be the most sophisticated amateur rocket flight computer in the world. Andrew, do you want to add anything about this?
No, not really. It's just sad that it's still the most sophisticated and nobody else has passed it. I'll take this opportunity to talk about one thing before we hit you with all this technology and all these projects. The thing that really sets PSAS apart from every other student group is its super, super, super interdisciplinary nature. So all those firsts and all the bragging rights that Katie was talking about, those are because we had CS students working with EEs, fighting with MEs for space in the rocket. And when you throw and you herd all these cats together, you get something much more rich than just MEs or just EEs or just CS. And so that's part of this whole PSAS thing is we are training you to work on interdisciplinary teams on a systems level engineering project that's got safety critical components that, and we're trying to run it like a true space program. And so it's just a great way of, you can see we're not the best in the world, but we've got parts of this program are like no others literally in the world, which is kind of neat.
So if you get involved with us, you can actually brag to your friends that you're involved in a quote unquote amateur space program.
Yeah.
Another technology that we've demonstrated on LV2 is real-time telemetry. So we can actually get a feed of information back from the rocket while it's in flight. So we can tell its speed and its position. And here are some videos. Have to use the mouse. Okay. Okay. So that's a ground-based video of LV2 taking off. I apologize for my internet connection. Then here's another one with the cameras mounted on the launch rail as well as in other places.
And this, I think, is at like 60 frames per second or more. It's definitely slowed down.
And here's a video demonstrating a roll control system, which uses these little canard fins and a freely rotating fin can.
So as far as we know, this is one of the very first actually controlled amateur rockets. We've not found anybody doing it before this, which is kind of cool. The yellow line is the roll rate and the red line is the control authority on the little canards.
Then this is my favorite video. It's a 360 degree video from the viewpoint of the rocket. And it always starts out with a little bee that buzzes by the camera, which is great.
The true star of the show.
Yes. Look down, see the smoke coming, and we're off. What you're seeing down there is Central Oregon. That's where we hold our launches from. And that's the flight, well, that's the camp line.
Did you already say this is Central Oregon, Brothers, Oregon?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I said Central Oregon. Yeah, the place is called Brothers, and it's out in the middle of a field, pretty much in the middle of nowhere, past Bend.
It's a four-hour drive away, and if you work with us, we'll have another launch this April, and we'll all go out and spend the evening outside stargazing with telescopes and then launch a rocket the next morning. It's pretty cool.
So we're about at apogee right here, and that's the nose cone deploying so that the parachute will come out. And the video gets a little disorienting because that's the rocket actually flipping over on its end in flight. And now it's dangling from the parachute. So if you were able to actually ride one of these rockets somehow, this is what it would look like. And all of these videos are on our YouTube page. So feel free to go back and check these out whenever you like. So strategic projects. We are working on not just rockets, but satellites now too. So we're going to talk about ORSAT in a little bit. First, we're going to continue about rockets with some talk about Launch Vehicle 3, a liquid fuel engine, and then we'll get into Launch Vehicle 4, which we're doing for the Base 11 Space Challenge, which is, this was mentioned before, this is kind of an XPRIZE competition for university teams competing to be the first to send a liquid-propelled rocket to the edge of space within 3 years of the competition's start, which was in late 2018. There's $1 million of potential prize money, and as was mentioned, we've won $15,000 in the first phase already. And through this competition, we're also getting access to industry professionals and industry-level safety and best practices training.
So going over the safety training, so all of the Base 11 team members are required to do the online, the Base 11 safety training. It has a couple of videos and safety material, which is required for like the safe design process and also for the safety protocols which are required in the launch site. And we also have quizzes in between this safety module. If you're going to be part of the Base 11 team building rockets, it's mandatory for you to do the safety training. And the second one is the NASA LOX training videos. This is specific to the propulsion team members. And if you do this training, you can add a skill set to your resume. You can learn the oxygen compatibility assessment skill set. So that's pretty cool to add on to your resume. Okay. That's
it. So with business functions, it gives you a great opportunity to utilize and expand knowledge you're learning at the School of Business. With the Base 11 competition, these functions cross over into PSAS operations as well. You'll be focusing on project timelines and Gantt charts, corporate outreach, fundraising, event planning, and community outreach, along with marketing, advertising, and social media. So it's a great way to leverage and practice what you're learning in school and take it into real world applications.
So now we're gonna talk about Launch Vehicle 3. This is a composite airframe tech demonstrator.
Like Chris just said, this is PSAS's carbon composite airframe. As you can see in the bottom, the whole rocket is modular. And each 6-inch diameter module, with the exception of the avionics module, is made of basically a carbon composite sandwich, where the outside is carbon fiber and the inside is this Nomex honeycomb core you can see in the picture to the right. With this new airframe, the strength to weight ratio is about 5 times better than LV2. And the airframe was designed with DATCOM and OpenRocket. Here's a video of a layup example. Basically, if you like working with your hands, working on LV3.1 will definitely give you that opportunity. And here's a picture of our rocket.
Just to clarify, that is LV3.0. That is our previous rocket, not the one we are currently working on.
Yes, good catch.
And here's why.
Yep. So LV3.0 was launched in May 2018, and it flew about 2 kilometers before RUD, which stands for Rapid Unscheduled Disassembly. We did do a formal failure analysis, and it wasn't the carbon fiber that was the issue, it was our coupling rings. So we fixed that, and we also strengthened the module layup process while we were at it. And so now we're aiming to fly again, and that's going to be LV3.1. That's an image of LV3.1, but keep in mind it's missing a module. And we've got a plan to launch it April 2021 currently for launch 14.
Exact date to be determined.
Yes.
So I can pick up here. So one of the things that separates PSAS from a lot of other amateur rocketry groups is we use an entirely electromechanical recovery system. Most groups use some sort of pyrotechnics to separate the nose cone from the rest of the rocket, but we've found a way to do it without, and we'll get a little more in depth with that in a sec, but we use a two parachute system. We have a drogue chute that comes off at apogee and slows us down a little bit, and then a main parachute once we get to a designated height that'll bring us down at a safe speed so we can recover all the parts. And we have an upcoming drop test. We have had the unfortunate happenstance that every time we try and do a drop test, an act of God happens. So we are not telling anybody the dates anymore. And if you stick around, you'll hear about it when it happens. So this is a little GIF of how we separate the nose cone. We actually use surgical tubing to give us that force to separate it. But in order to do that, we use a geared motor along with a twist coupling with gear teeth. So the motor turns that and unlocks the nose cone, which allows for the separation, which completely replaces any needs for pyrotechnical separation.
Cool. So the reaction control system is one of the newer things that we are working on and taking on again. So if you recall from one of the videos earlier on, we had a mechanical reaction control system, but that really only works at lower altitudes. So once we get above 30 to 40 kilometers, it's no longer, that type of system no longer works. So now we're using, we're going to be integrating a cold gas jet reaction control system, into our rocket. Slide 46, Risto. Since it looks like the screen share stopped for a moment.
Yeah, it closed down on me random.
Yeah, so we're going to be using compressed nitrogen gas, which will, wow, words. Yeah, the RCS will be using compressed nitrogen gas. It will put out about 8 newtons in the roll direction, and then about 11 newtons in pitch and yaw. Because of ITAR rules, we can only do we can only control one of those axes before the government considers it a guided missile. So for LV3.1, we are just doing roll control, and then for LV4, which we'll talk about later on in this presentation, we'll be trying to integrate all three axes. This reaction control system has 3D printed bell nozzles that were created by our 2016 capstone. It has PWM throttling and robust control. Then the next slide has, yes, thank you, Katie, for that clarification. ITAR is International Traffic in Arms Regulations. So we'll go ahead and do this video.
Do you want to do that with the sound?
Sure. it's a little difficult to hear, but this is basically, this is an example of the nozzles firing and showing the specifically the shape that the gas jet is making as it's leaving the nozzle. And then in the next video is a demonstration with more of a modular shape of the RCS system actively correcting its orientation. So yeah, with the, do you want to try and put sound on for a little bit? I guess replay it.
If it'll ever load again.
that last section of the video always gets a little difficult to show on Zoom, but basically what that video was showing was the reaction control system stabilizing itself and turning any or taking any change in roll and countering it to go back to a stable orientation.
So now we'll talk about the liquid fuel engine.
Okay, so one of our projects that we've been working on for a while now, and you can see here some of our earlier iterations, is a liquid-fueled rocket engine. All of the launch vehicles that we've seen up until now have all been powered by commercial solid rocket motors. But one of the keys to getting bigger motors and longer run times to really fuel the next generation launch vehicle is going to be switching to a liquid rocket fuel. Our designs have been for an alcohol and liquid oxygen rocket motor. And as you can see here, we've done some work in regenerative cooling as well as advanced manufacturing techniques like 3D printing. So one of the things that has been worked on in the recent past is newer designs for the liquid fueled rocket engine. We're trying to work towards right now, we've got a lot of work in the past that have been sort of basic research prototypes. We're really trying to get to the point where we can get something manufactured and tested. So we've been working on refining the design, at least for the prototype version, such that we can actually manufacture it and see if all of our calculations have been, are borne out by tests. Okay, so in order to test a liquid-fueled rocket engine without a rocket, you need a test stand. So the spinning, I really like the spinning animation. The spinning animation you see here is the current version of our liquid-fueled engine test stand. So we're currently working actually on plumbing and mounting components now, which is very exciting. Ultimately, the goal of this system is to be able to test a variety of different rocket engines up to about a 2,000-pound rocket force rocket engine. Another unique and pretty cool feature of this, and I don't want to step on SAR toes if that is another slide, is that it's going to be fully automated for remote operation. So it's going to be a very safe system in that everything will be electronically controlled with data acquisition and remote operation. Sorry. is this still me or do I want to hand it over to Jennifer now?
Jennifer, are you here?
This slide real fast. So yeah, the SAR project is the control and data acquisition for the test stand. There is a state machine in there that controls the valve states and also monitors all of the pressure and temperature. And there's some manual emergency stops just in case something goes wrong. And all of the data is stored at a safe distance. Also, all of the control is at a safe distance. So.
I can grab this one as well. Okay. So for our ground-based test system, we're planning on using a large quantity of very large, heavy, high-pressure gas tanks to provide the pressure for the engine, to feed the engine. We think that's going to be too heavy to fly on a rocket. So instead of that, we're planning on using lower-pressure tanks with an electric pump system. We've had several prototypes of this right now, and the last work we did on this was using a 2.5 kilowatt-hour electric motor from a remote control boat. And so we're really looking to help refine the design and come up with a refinement of the design that gets us the pressures and the flow rates that we need to make the next generation rocket engine run.
Speaking of next generation rockets,
Hello. So this is LV4. It's a rough CAD mockup. It's our entry in the Base 11 team competition, and we're aiming for 100 kilometers. That is a little over 6 meters, and it's 12 inches in diameter, so pretty big rocket. There are a lot of things to work on still for it. It's mostly in, it's not supposed to be in an early stage of design, but it kind of is. And we're aiming to have the design concretized by around mid-December for the critical design review. So if you want to take part in the definition, there's a lot of room.
All right.
Yes, so we have isogrid tanks, and they are essentially a structure that is normally basically cut out from a flat plate and then welded together. And they are used, commonly used in rockets to store the cryogenics. And all of the specific pattern of those triangles that you see are very specific to the forces that you need based on your specific rocket and the fuel. And so it's in a very preliminary design phase. And we're also looking into the possibility of orthogrids versus isogrids. That's it.
All right. And now we're gonna move on to ORSAT. So if rockets aren't your thing, then maybe satellites. We're currently working on Oregon's Zero and first satellites. And really that's our first and second, but we use computer science counting. So first off, ORSAT. This was originally planned to be Oregon's first satellite. It'll be going to space in, I think we missed a change in the 2020, late 2022, early 2023, I think. And we're being given a free ride to space courtesy of the NASA CubeSat Launch Initiative. And this design also will serve as the future rocket avionics system for LV-4. ORSAT will be taken up to the International Space Station at roughly 400 kilometers altitude, and then it'll be hooked out the airlock. Do we not have that video on here anymore? I guess we got rid of it. So the secret primary mission of ORSAT is to not catch fire and actually work in space. Shout out to the thermal team. We have a group of mechanical engineers making sure that this will actually not happen. Mission one is called ORSAT Live. So this is really cool. It'll be real-time video for high school students from space. Basically, a 400-kilometer long selfie stick. So they will build little handheld ground stations that they can plug into their laptops phones and actually download the video directly from the satellite. Mission is the Cirrus Fluxcam. So this is a climate science mission in collaboration with University College and University Maryland. And so this will reflect, this will measure the reflected sunlight from cirrus clouds, which are very difficult to measure without specialized equipment. And these measurements will help improve global climate models. And then we've got mission three, which is to demonstrate open source hardware. Does anyone want to pipe in to talk about the open source hardware?
So there's two parts of a satellite. The first is the mission or the payloads, which is what Rissa was just talking about, which is the cameras and the live from space video and the Cirrus Flux Cam. And then there's all the guts of the satellite. There's the solar power and the batteries and the radios and the computers, and that's called a bus. And so the ORSAT bus is something that we'll be demonstrating. It's an open source, it's one of the very few, very completely open source satellites. And other people can then grab our designs and use them, which is very cool.
Then as a piece of ground support equipment, you've got university class ground station. Of course, it's the worst name ever. We came up with it ourselves, thank you. And they're kind of expensive. It costs, I think maybe a little more than 10 grand to put this one, ultimately to build it and put it up on the roof of our engineering building. And it has a 2 meter, 70 centimeter radio. Dimitri, did you want to talk about the software and mission server elements of it?
Yeah, so it turns out that once we actually launch a satellite, we don't want it to be just a brick in space. That or it'll be the most expensive brick in space. So enter the ground station. This entire antenna is based on what's called SDR, which is software-defined radio, taking actual radio signals and turning them into digital packets that we can interact with. And a lot of that is based on some tech that some other company did, Lime Microsystems, and they did made a card called Lime SDR. A lot of our work is based on their work, which is pretty cool. And all of our stuff is, once again, open source, open hardware, all of that good stuff. The antenna that's on the right there is actually on the roof of the engineering building right now. I think it's still got a collection of birds on it as we speak, but eventually it'll be fixed and we can actually make it rotate again. But once ORSAT Zero is in space, we'll actually try to use that as well as SatNogs to actually communicate with our satellites. Because holy crap, we actually almost have a satellite in space. Still a lot to process. Anyway.
Yeah.
A lot of this kind of ground station work requires a lot of CEs and CS people. The CE people to kind of help with the Lime SDR and the conversion of radio to digital. And then we need software people. So congratulations, if you admitted to being a CE or a CS, you are trapped. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Please see Ryan after class because we need you right now. A lot of work includes for the software people. For ORSAT Live, we want a mechanism for talking to the satellite so we can schedule passbys. So anybody that wants to schedule the CFC cam can do so through a particular website that we've set up. And we can send that information to the satellite and let it know, hey, please point in this direction at this time, stuff like that. And then we also need all of the infrastructure, the databases, the in-house user programs for accepting requests and all of that. We have some of that and a lot of the infrastructure is there, but there's still a lot more to be done. So yeah, please see Ryan after class. You don't get to go home tonight.
Or for the next 3 years.
All right. And so we mentioned that
against my will.
We mentioned that ORSAT is no longer the actual Oregon-built satellite going up to space. That's because we superseded ORSAT Zero. So we were given the opportunity to build a 1U version of ORSAT, basically 1U being 10 by 10 by 10 centimeters, so half the size. And we'll be able to send that up in second quarter 2021. So coming up this spring, the ORSAT structure is now designed to be scalable from 1U to 3U. And so we were given this opportunity and we're like, okay, why not take it? So Andrew, do you want to talk about this a little bit?
Sure. So this was a huge surprise to us. We thought we were going to fly ORSAT 1 in mid-2022. And then people came and said, hey, we can fly you a smaller satellite, but you have to give it to us in January. So we're all panicking. And this is what we came up with, which is the smaller version of ORSAT. It's called a 1U CubeSat. On the left, you can see it with the antennas stowed for before flight, and then they pop out like on the right. If you go to the next slide. You'll see that it's not just vaporware. We've actually built this. And this is prototype one. So you can see the batteries in the bottom. You see the lens of the star tracker. There are, we hope, three Linux boxes on the thing, three independent Linux boxes, and a bunch of microcontrollers running real-time operating systems. There are solar power systems on the outside. And on the top, there's the radio system that talks back down to the ground. So we're really excited about this. It's really, really coming up fast. We literally have 3 months to pull a flight-ready satellite together, so we need your help.
So as Andrew just mentioned, we've got until January to complete Orsa Zero and hand it off. And then that will go into space in second quarter 2021, probably in April. And then the original ORSAT, we are looking to work on it until summer 2021 and then hand it off to NanoRax, which is our rideshare provider, so that they can have it sent up to the International Space Station in the following spring. So then we will have a spree of one satellite per year for at least 2 years, which is exciting for us. So help us get to space. This is why you're all here, right? Join Portland State's own homegrown space program. Whatever you do, whatever you are studying, we have a place for you, or we can find a place for you. To us, rockets and satellites are really big deal, especially because there's nobody else in Oregon doing satellites, and there's very few rocketry activity in the state. So yeah, join us. Space is cool. We'll give you hands-on experience. Hopefully, as soon as our labs open up, we will. We'll also give you experience doing CAD design and simulations and other things that would be of value for you and your portfolio. And this is really good resume fodder, especially if you want to go into the aerospace industry. One thing I hear recruiters say every single time they talk is they want to see what projects you've worked on. So we know this has been a lot of information, but we want to help you to get started. So if you haven't already, you can send an email to aerospace+join@pdx.edu and you'll get a automated response with a bunch of resources. And included in these resources will be information about our group. And we're about to do some breakout rooms and we'll get you added to our Slack and have you talking to our project leads. Can I get somebody to put the link to the breakout room document in the chat, please, so everyone has access to it? And then we're not going to switch over to those other rooms yet. To give you just a picture of all the different kinds of projects that we have, we've got this big unruly list here, just to give you an idea. Tooling up, periodically we'll do workshops and we'll help you set up with these different tools. There may be in the not too distant future some online workshops through the electronics prototyping lab as well, and we will announce those as they are scheduled. And upcoming events, we're going to have a LV4 system discussion on Sunday at 1. This will be great for new people who are interested in working on our 100-kilometer rocket, because we're going to go over mission requirements and things like that. We've got our liquid fuel engine test fire, fingers crossed, sometime this winter. And LV3.1 will be launched in Brothers sometime this April. And then around the same time, we'll have ORSAT Zero going in orbit, and a year later, ORSAT going in. So there's a lot of stuff to look forward to. So yeah, stay in touch, check out our websites, And we have meetings every Tuesday at 7, the PSAS general meetings, and then we also have ORSAT specific meetings every Friday at 2. You can go to these websites and you'll see a link to our calendar. And now we will go into our breakout rooms. So
actually, Risto, can I say something first?
Yeah.
So I want to echo what people are saying in the chat, because I think it's really important. So what you've just walked into is 20 years worth of history and some pretty serious engineering and logistics and organization. And the way that PSAS works is you don't need anything to join. You just join and you find a thing to work on. And it may be that it takes you a while to work on. So the people who are most successful in PSAS will just start showing up to the Tuesday night meetings for rockets and everything else, showing up to the Friday 2 p.m. meetings for ORSAT, finding out what they're interested in, maybe saying, well, I'm interested in the Cirrus Flux camera because I want to do image processing, or I'm interested in cryogenic fuel tanks, so I'll go to LV4. They're all anything that sort of draws you the most, go work on those sub teams and just hang out. We've had people who've hung out for 6 months to a year before they've started to really feel comfortable to work on stuff. Now we'll try and get you to work more quickly than that, but just hang out, check out what's going on, read the onboarding stuff, ask questions, be active. It's especially hard now in the pandemic, but as the pandemic rolls up in the next year, we hope, we'll have actual meetings, we'll have actual launches, and we'll be getting together, which is much more fun and exciting than Zoom. But for now, just come hang out in our meetings and sub-team meetings and ask questions and be obnoxious, and we'd love to have you. This is not about necessarily satellites and rockets, although it is. It's about you guys learning how to work on an interdisciplinary systems level project.